So my conclusion at a certain point there was that we're obliged to regard the consecrations as valid. So what I did in 91, I put all my research together in an article. You can find that on the website. And that's the point. You know, we change our positions because we learn and we discover other facts. And also, I discovered that Thuc did issue a consecration certificate, in fact. And Father Kelly, remember, he used the absence as the certificate. I remember him at the meetings as the principal to impugn the validity of the Thuc consecrations. Oh, you don't have a certificate. It's not official proof. You have to all this rigmarole and witnesses as to matter and form. No one says that. Okay, though it's a whole canonical rigmarole that you'd go through for an ecclesiastical trial, maybe. Right? But so then the certificate, oh, you know, you've got to have one and everything. Principal objection. Then I found one in 92, and then he ignored it and now started to talk about Thuc's mental state. Okay? Very simply, my position. I'll explain it to you on the validity of the consecrations. The standard procedure for verifying when someone receives a sacrament is this. The priest ascertains the fact that the ceremony took place. You come, you say you've been baptized, okay? You have a certificate. If you don't have a certificate, one can't be had. Maybe there's some other proof. Maybe there's photos of your baptism. Maybe there's someone who is there who said that, yeah, the priest baptized you, okay? So did it occur? Then the minister who performed the rite, all right? Was he a validly ordained Catholic priest? Does a Catholic priest do it? Right? So you ask the recipient or the parents. And they'll tell you, oh yeah, okay, sure, he was. And the rite used, did they use the traditional rite? Or the Vatican II rite for a sacrament? Oh, they used the traditional rite. Okay, fine. Then you conclude that ceremony occurred, right? Validly ordained priest did it, used a traditional rite, valid. No further questions. No rigmarole, special witnesses, all this other stuff. Okay, we apply that to the Thuc consecrations. What you can ascertain is the fact, first of all, that the ceremonies occurred. I've got a consecration certificate, right, that attests to that. There are published photos of it, of both Gerard de Lauriers, from whom Bishop Sanborn derives his apostolic succession, and Carmona's, from whom Bishop Dolan derives his, of their consecrations. There are photos. And there are numerous articles about it, saying that they had a consecration. From all this stuff, certificate, photos, etc. Then you have a minister who performed the rite, Thuc, okay? Validly consecrated Catholic bishop. And then the rite used. What rite did they use? Okay? And you find out that they used the rite of episcopal consecration in the 1908 Roman Pontifical. And you know that from info I'm going to give you. There are captions published with photos of the ceremony stating that he used it. There's an interview conducted under oath with Hiller, Dr. Hiller, who is one of the men who was present, a sworn affidavit from another fellow, Heller, who said that Thuc used the Roman Pontifical. There was a published interview with Gerard de Lauriers saying that the old pontifical was used for it, and then a second interview that Father Collins, I think, did with him, and Gerard again said that it was the traditional pontifical. If you knew Gerard, he was a very devout, faithful, traditional Catholic priest. Right? Not an unreliable man. So you conclude then, so you have the fact of the ceremony, you know what rite was used, and you know that Thuc was a valid bishop. So you conclude, just as you would with any other sacrament, that it occurred, validly consecrated bishop, you use the rite, bang, it's valid. And that's the presumption. You have to conclude that. Thereafter, then in canon law and moral theology, validity is presumed and invalidity must be proven, as Father Jenkins correctly asserts. Look at the quotes on C. I think it's C. Yeah, the salmon-colored page. Generally in canon law, what we've just said about presuming validity and proving invalidity, This, the canonist Wanamaker says, is the queen of presumptions, which holds that the actor contract is valid until invalidity is proved. Then, next quote, and this is from Cardinal Gasparri, who is also the compiler of the 1917 Code of Canon Law. And he says that an act, especially as one as solemn as an ordination, must be regarded as valid as long as invalidity would not be clearly demonstrated. And then also, you have to presume that the intention was correct. And this is from the theologian Leeming. This principle is affirmed as certain theological doctrine taught by the church, to deny which would be theologically rash. The minister is presumed to do what the rite means. Okay, briefly, what are the defects that would mess up an episcopal consecration, right? That would you would have to prove now to prove that it was doubtful or invalid, right? But you'd have to prove the idea of like proving something doubtful. You have to find a reason for invalidity in the reality of the rite. You can't just say, "Oh, I doubted because I wasn't there, and I think Thuc was a crazy old geezer." Okay, doesn't work that way. You have to prove from what happened. The consecrating bishop did not impose hands. That's the matter of the sacrament. That he